driving down Santa Clarita, and it seemed like it was a full-blown storm. And but I was just praising God, you know, for the reminder of his faithfulness, that he brings rain, that he gives life. And, you know, the rain, and some of you right now, you maybe are in a rainy season in your life, but without the rain, without the difficulty, there isn't growth, there isn't new life. And God often uses it in our lives to draw us closer to him. And this morning, we're encouraged to be here so that we can get in his word. And I'm excited about the message in John this morning about the peace of God. How many of you guys see that everywhere we look, you know, when we look around us, there's something that's trying to rob us of our peace? Amen. But Jesus said, I'll give you my peace. The world can't take it from you. The world didn't give it to you. And his peace is in spite, it's regardless of what circumstances we're in. And so this morning, allow God to speak to you. Every one of us need that message. And as Christians, we need reminders of who we are in Christ and what we have. So this will be an opportunity today. But I'm going to pray. We're going to get into worship. Lord, we ask for your glory to fall on this place, Lord. Like the rain outside, God, we ask for your spirit to move in here. And Lord, I know that you want to speak to hearts. I know that you want to change lives. I know that you want to encourage and strengthen your people. And God, we are in interesting times in history right now, God, and we trust that you are going to bring us through them, and you've already given us the insight through your word. But Lord, I pray you would do a work in our hearts, that we would leave here not filled with fear and uncertainty, but with your peace. And God, we thank you for that. And we're going to wait on you, Lord, in the meantime, God. We love you. We praise you. It's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. Amen. Let's stand as we begin worshiping.
Filled with the power of We proclaim our love for him, 'cause he is faithful, he is glorious, and he is Jesus. The God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There is joy in the house of the Lord, there is joy in the house of the Lord today. Be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Lord, we shout out your praise. Oh, we shout out your praise. We were the beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't don't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Oh, Lord, we shout out your praise. Praise the Lord. Oh, we praise the Lord. We shout out your praise.
Thank you.
the way you always loved me. Now I get to love you in return. Now I get to love you in return. Now nothing is holding me back from you, Redeemer of my soul. Now nothing can hold me back from you. Your love will never let me go. Oh, I know your love will never let me go. We know your love will never let us go. Jesus, all glory, all honor, all dominion belongs to Jesus. All glory, all honor, all dominion belongs to Jesus. Oh,
Thank you for your precious blood, Lord Jesus, that covers all of our iniquities. Your blood today still speaks and it says forgiven to all who come to you, Lord. And I thank you. There's power in your blood. I plead the blood over this nation, over our children. Lord, if you do not show up, Lord, we have no hope. And God, we just thank you that you still, in the midst of everything, you give us peace, you give us joy unspeakable. God, your glory is amazing. And Lord, we thank you for the time of worship this morning. I pray you would be glorified as your word is taught. And God, that our lives would be conformed to the image of Christ. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Blessing. And Cindy and Brad, you guys are a blessing. A few quick announcements this morning. If you're here visiting, I want to encourage you to come back. Next week, Pastor Shane will be back in the pulpit going through the book of Revelation. We're nearing the end of that, and it's been an amazing series and a timely series as we see prophecy coming to pass in front of our eyes. I believe we are in the beginning of the end times. We are seeing those growing pains. We're seeing those birthing pains, as the Bible talks about in Daniel. And I want to encourage us, as we see that day approaching, to remain faithful, to press into God in these times. And you know, our church has a unique calling, and of course our heartbeat is for revival. Our heartbeat is for seeing men and women repent and trust Christ. But I also believe that God has called us as a church to be in the harvest too. I'm thankful that God so graciously saw fit to let us live in such a time like this. I was reminded last week, you guys saw me baptize my friend from the gym. He's about 6'10". I was looking up to him. Raiden, and I was just reminded once again that the harvest is plenteous, that there are people who will come and who will believe. And what God has called us to is just to be faithful and to be witnesses. Now, how many of you guys say, you know what, I can tell someone my testimony. I could tell someone how I was saved. And that's something that we all can do. And one of the greatest tools that we have in evangelism is our testimony. And I was able to connect with Raiden on the simple fact that, you know, he was raised with his father being abusive and then eventually leaving. He shared it with me, and I said, well, I understand that, and built that friendship, and God used it. And so I just want to encourage us, church family, let's be on mission. We prayed it this morning in the prayer meeting, that Westside would be on mission. So when Jesus cracks through that eastern sky, that we are faithful to what he's called us to do. And so that's my prayer. But just a few quick announcements this morning. I want to remind the ladies of the tea coming up, women's tea coming up May the 4th. I believe there are signups in the lobby for that. Still some tickets for that, I believe. So if you have not already purchased your ticket, those things are hot. They go really quickly. So do not procrastinate on this, because then you won't be able to go. And every year we get it, people calling later and asking, are there any more tickets? And we have to say, unfortunately, no, we have no more space. So I want to encourage you ladies to go ahead and purchase those today. Also, this Wednesday night, we are praying about what we're going to do, but we're planning a worship night, but Pastor Shane may give a teaching. He may give a message. So I want to encourage us to be here either way. And we, at our church, we are a worshiping church. Amen. We love to worship, and so if it's a worship night, let's be here. If there's going to be the Word of God open, let's be here. So I want to encourage you to come. And then Ignite, teens, if you're here this morning, I want to encourage you to be here Wednesday as well, because I'll be teaching over in Ignite, and over the next several months, I'll be preaching more to our teens. We want to pour into the next generation. And I believe that God is raising up a remnant in this generation. There's a boldness. There's a fire. You know, you guys see some of the young men and women in our church. I love a lot of these young men in here who are on fire. They're away at, several of them are away at Emmaus right now. And we're praying for them. But God is raising up a generation. I was thinking about it this week. You know, the generation that was that went through the Red Sea out of Egypt, that generation, the older generation, they spent their lives wandering in the wilderness. And they eventually died in the wilderness. And God used the next generation to go into the promised land to fulfill his promise to Abraham. And I want us to take note, you know, the God of the Bible, he's still the God of today. And if we aren't on mission, if we are like the children of Israel, a lot of us over the last few years, we've been grumbling a lot. We've been complaining. We've been off the plan of God and worrying about what's going on with the economy, worrying about, you know, all these other things. And let me remind us all that our lives are but a vapor, and then we just have a short time to finish our course, to be faithful to God. And so, you know, we could spend our lives wandering in the wilderness of this world and never accomplish anything for the kingdom of God. And so I think God, oftentimes he has to skip a generation, not because he wants to, but because, just like he said, I sought for a man to stand in the gap, and there was none. And so this is something that I think we should personally take to heart, to think about. Am I a laborer in the harvest, or am I just loitering through life? Am I just wandering through the wilderness? And then eventually, after my 70 years on this planet, on this rock, I'll go into eternity. And this is a reality for a lot of believers. So I want to encourage us, let's be on mission. All right. That's the only convicting thing I'm going to say, I think, today. I'm going to be more of an encouragement in the message today. Take your Bibles with me to John 14. We're going to finish up John 14 this morning. John 14, we're going to start in verse 25. The title of the message this morning is Jesus' gift of peace. Jesus' gift of peace. Is there any price you could put on the peace of God? Absolutely not. It's priceless. And Jesus has given us this gift. I'll start reading in verse number 25. You're there in your Bible this morning. Say amen. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard me say to you, I am going away and coming back to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced because I said I am going to the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming, and he has nothing in me, but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, so I do. Arise, let us go from here. Sarah Winchester was the widower of Winchester, the gunmaker. How many of you guys have maybe owned a Winchester pistol or a rifle or very popular gun? And, of course, she inherited a large sum of money when her husband passed, and she began the construction of the Winchester Mansion in San Jose, California. I think we have a picture of it. And this massive structure has over 160 rooms, more than 10,000 windows, This mansion would have doorways and staircases that led to blank walls. It is estimated that she spent more, in today's valuation, she spent more than $70 million building this largely pointless construction, all for a desperate attempt to find peace. You see, Sarah feared that she would be haunted by the ghosts of those who were killed by the weapons her husband manufactured. And she felt as long as she would be in construction of this house that she would not be tormented by these spirits in her mind. And so she continued this construction countless years, and she had workers around the clock that would work on this monstrosity of a house. And now in San Jose, it is a tourist attraction. Anybody here ever visit it? I've never. But many people today are seeking peace in other places besides in the relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand that the only true peace, lasting peace, is found in a relationship with Jesus? And Jesus is speaking to his disciples in the upper room once again, and he told them some troubling news that troubled their heart, that he would be leaving them in the beginning of the chapter 14. And he went on and he began to give them assurances. And he's going to continue and do that in our verses this morning. He's going to give them promises. And I want you to notice with me the promises that he gives that would provide peace to these men. I want you to see he promises a heavenly home. In verse number 2 of chapter 14, he said that he was going to prepare a place for them so that where he is, there they may be also. He was going to prepare a special place for these men and for all who will place their faith in him. Let me remind you this morning, if you're saved, there is a special construction taking place in heaven for you. I was thinking about Raiden. He's 6'10". I assume he'll still be that height in heaven. And so his place of residence in heaven now will have to be customized to fit his height, right? And I believe that Jesus is that type of a God, a caring God, that he's preparing such a place for every one of us who love him and look forward to his appearing. It's custom made. How many of you guys said, I've always desired to build a custom home? You may not be able to do it this side of eternity, but I want you to know that God, the creator of everything, he's preparing a place for you and I who are in Christ. Let that bring you peace, that you don't have to worry about anything, that the worst thing that you'll ever face will lead to the best time of your existence. You know, the worst thing is death that we'll ever face, right? And we all have it coming, and let's be real, that's something that we all will face. But let me tell you, that is just a transition from this life to the next. For the Christian, for the believer, those who have the relationship with Jesus, it's just a transition. And then you are in glory. Then you are in heaven with him. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. How many of you are looking forward to that day? I'm looking forward to that day. Let's get excited about it. I'm telling you, you can be too earthly minded to be of no heavenly good. The old saints thought about heaven. They wrote songs about heaven. And like when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. And let me tell you, these were people who were in the midst of trials and difficulties. And the thing that brought them peace was their relationship with Jesus and the promise of an eternal hope, an eternal home with him in heaven. And let me remind somebody today, maybe your peace has been robbed this week because of financial burden or health issue. Let me remind you this morning that if you are in Christ, you have a heavenly home waiting for you. You have an inheritance. See, I may not leave my children two nickels to rub together, but I'm thankful that by God's grace, they're going to trust on Jesus Christ. I'm going to leave them a greater inheritance, a relationship, hopefully, with Jesus Christ. The gift that keeps on giving. Not only did he promise a home in heaven to all who believe, but he said he would return. He said, I will come again in verse number 3. He said, I'm going to come again. he's going to come to this earth literally again. And I want you to be reminded of this. You know, the kings in their kingdoms and, you know, the rulers of this world are trying to posture themselves as if they have control. They're trying to play God, we see it. They're trying to control narratives and to influence people and societies. But ultimately, all of that is going to be brought to none when King Jesus steps on the scene. He is going to rule on this literal earth, we believe, for 1,000 years. And he is going to rule, the Bible says, with a rod of iron. There will be no insurrections under his rule. There will be absolute authority. There will be no wiggle room. There will be no one who can cheat the system of justice under Jesus' rule. And let me tell you this, we will be with him, whether you or I pass away before this time, or if we're on the earth when he does return. The Bible says those who go before us, he will bring with him. And those who are here and remain, we will be with him, and we will rule and reign with him on this earth. He is returning, and this is what he's telling to these 12 men, these disciples who would go through persecution, who would go through ultimately each one of them, save John the beloved, would all die martyrs' deaths. But Jesus is saying, I'm going to come again, and because I will resurrect from the dead, because I will return literally from heaven, you can have peace in the midst of what you're going to face. Not only did he say he promised a heavenly home and his return, but he promised his power on these men's lives. In verse number 12, he said that he would be with them and that they would do greater works. They would have a greater realm of influence, and even he did. He said because he was going away from them that the Holy Spirit would come, we'll see in just a moment, and that he would empower them to be influential in the world. You know why the church has lost its influence in America? It's because the Holy Spirit isn't in most churches. Listen to me. The church in times past would impact culture. The church in times past had a power and had an authority in the world. And now we've been content to just have our little meetings and to not have impact in the culture. But this isn't what I see in Scripture. Biblical Christianity always had dunamis power behind it. There was the power of God on the lives of these men and women, and they impacted. They turned their world upside down. But let me tell you, you can have that power, and I can have that power. It's available for us today. Do you understand that? This is why we talk about the power of the Holy Spirit so much here at this church. Because without the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives, there's no way we can do it. It's the wind in our sails. He is the only way that we can accomplish the will of God. So not only a heavenly home, not only did he promise these men that he would return, but he promised them that he would answer their prayers in verse 13 and 14. He said, anything that you ask in my name. Now, as we talked about before, this is not a, you know, blank check, and anything that your flesh wants to consume, you can ask for, but it's within the will of God. And he said, I will answer those prayers as they align with my will. And he said, you can come to me and I will hear you and I will answer you. How many of you guys are thankful for that promise? Some of you are waiting right now for that fulfillment in your life in some area. You're praying for the salvation of your spouse or your children, your prodigals. You may be praying, but let me tell you, that's in the will of God, and God is going to move. I believe it. I have faith. You may not see it with your earthly eyes. You may be in heaven when God gets a hold of your spouse or your child who's wayward, but God is going to answer that prayer. I believe it in Jesus' name. I heard it this morning in the prayer meeting. There was a family who their grandma or the husband's mom is on, you know, her final days. She's in hospice. And she'd asked that maybe we'd go down and pray for her, and we had made plans to do that. But before we could even get down there, she told me this morning that God sent someone to her room and witnessed to her there. And she accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as her Savior. And she's going to be in heaven. I'm telling you, it's powerful. They were praying. We were praying. We prayed. God hears and answers prayer. That's not just a cliche saying. Our God is alive and well in heaven. He's on the throne, and he's moving on our behalf. Not only did he promise them that he'll answer prayer, but he promises us the Holy Spirit's presence permanently. You know, we have it better than David and Abraham and Joseph, the Old Testament. You know, we have it better than them. You ever think about that? There was times when the Spirit would come on David, but then the Spirit would leave. There were times when Samson, the Spirit would come on him and he'd kill 1,500 men with the jawbone of a donkey. And then it would leave him. But for you and I, and for these men, what Jesus is telling them, what he's promising them, is that the Holy Spirit is going to dwell with you shortly, permanently. Never leave you or forsake you. You know, you have the second person or the third person of the Godhead within you. Within you, if you're saved this morning, the Holy Spirit, he will always be with you. He will never leave you. Let that encourage you. Let that bring you peace this morning. You are never alone. Wherever you are in life, whatever you're facing, you will not face that alone. This is what Jesus is promising when he says to them, I'm saying to you right now, I've spoken these things to you while I'm with you. So I want you to grasp this morning, church family. Jesus has promised these things to us as well. And we can let that be the source of our peace. But not only do we have the promise of peace, but I want you to see the person of peace. We've been talking about him. Look at verse 26. It says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all things that I said to you. You see, peace is found in the person of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not what some cults teach. He's not a force. He isn't something that, like the wind or an element. The Holy Spirit is a person. He can be grieved. We see it in the book of Acts. He can be quenched in our lives through sin. The Holy Spirit of God is all of God, but he is the one that the Father and the Lord Jesus would send to us to be our peace, to be within us, to dwell with us. And I want you to see his ministry in our lives as believers is what Jesus is laying out here. He's called the Helper or the Paraclete. He will be in you and he will come alongside of us. He is here to help us. You know, you don't have to parent alone. You don't have to serve God alone. You don't have to do anything. I think most times we utterly fail at things because we do not depend on the Holy Spirit. We don't listen to his still, small voice. How many times in hindsight has the Holy Spirit been telling us to do something or not to go somewhere or leading? And he's a still, small voice, and we neglect it, right? And then you look back and say, the Holy Spirit, we give the credit to our first thought or our intuition, and let me tell you, that's not it. That's the Holy Spirit. He's going to guide you. He's here to help us through this thing called life. And let me ask you, are you utilizing him? Holy Spirit, what would you have me to do? Holy Spirit, lead me. Should I date this person? Should I purchase this? Holy Spirit, lead me into your ways. Holy Spirit, I don't even know how to pray about this. Help me, Holy Spirit. How many of us, I think we neglect the Holy Spirit. Now, too many times, the Holy Spirit is grieved in our lives, so we can't hear his voice. We don't have peace. You know, you guys know, and I know, people who claim to be believers who are the last thing that they are peaceful. The last thing that they display in trials and tribulation is peace. And I can tell you this, because peace is found in the will of God. Peace is found in the will of God. These men were in the will of God, the disciples, right? They were as close to Jesus. They were in the room with Jesus. They were serving the Lord. They were in his will. They had left all and forsaken all and had come and followed Jesus. They were in the will of God. So the Holy Spirit was able to work. We'll see later, he is able to fill those types of believers who are in the will of God. Have you been outside the will of God and you just feel like there's just a heaviness? When you're caught in sin and you don't have peace, you don't sleep too well. Anybody been there? You don't have a desire for the things of God like before. You see, because we can grieve the Holy Spirit. And he's there to help us, to come alongside of us. The Bible says in verse 26 that the Father will send in Jesus' name. And he would, this is what his ministry will be also. He would teach them all things. He will teach us all things. Listen to me. There are some single moms in this room who have more wisdom than people who have several PhDs and degrees. You know why? Because they believe the word of God and they're in the will of God and let the Holy Spirit teach them. I promise you, the Bible says that he will teach us all things. We will have need of nothing. Hey, if you master one book in your life and one discipline in your life, I would encourage you to make it the word of God and allow the word of God, because who inspired the word of God? The Spirit of God. This is the mind of God. This is God's way. This is his teaching. This is the supernatural book, and the most amazing book ever penned. I'm telling you, this is the Spirit of God and penned. And so the Holy Spirit is going to lead us, and he's going to never contradict the word of God. I meet people all the time, oh, God just told me to leave my wife and because she wasn't my soulmate, and I'm going to go marry my girlfriend, my secretary, you know, and, you know, she understands me. I say, you fool. Listen to me. The world, and you see it in every media outlet, you see it everywhere, is listen to your heart. Do what you feel. That is opposite of what the Word of God says. I don't listen to my heart. If I listen to my heart, I'd be on the side of the road. I'd be dead already. And you would too. Because our heart is deceptively wicked above all things. Who can know it? Within us lies every wicked, vile, destitute desire that you can imagine. And so this is why we need the Holy Spirit to teach us, to guide us, to keep us away from the snare of the devil. You know the devil's out for us? He doesn't want your marriage to continue. He doesn't want your children to be taught the truth of the word. He doesn't want you to thrive. And so he's going to try to get you to listen to your heart and listen to his voice rather than the Holy Spirit. But Jesus is saying to these men, the Holy Spirit, when he comes in my name, he's going to teach you all things. You mean all things, Jesus? All things. He'll teach you what you need to do with your time, with your talent, with your treasure. He'll teach you how to navigate even the end times that we're living in. He will teach you all things. Aren't you thankful for that this morning? Say amen. Amen. The person of peace, the Spirit, he's our helper. He's been sent to indwell us, to lead us, teach us in all things. But he goes on, Jesus says, and he will bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. You see, he would supernaturally remind these men Jesus' word. Now, how many of you guys have, you know, maybe been witnessing or serving God in some way, and he and the Holy Spirit brings something to mind? Maybe he brings a scripture to mind. He reminds you of a situation, and it happens every single time I'm preaching the word of God. Like, he would bring a scripture He'd bring illustration. He will highlight what I believe he wants to say to someone, and I love it. You know, we aren't that smart as preachers. The Bible says that he's called the base things to confound the wise. So when you guys come up to us sometimes and say, hey, you were reading our mail. No, I wasn't reading your mail. The Holy Spirit, he knows you. It seems like, preacher, you were just talking to me today. Let me tell you, the Holy Spirit was talking to you. It wasn't me. I'm not that wise. I cannot comprehend like I would like to many times, but I want you to get this. The Holy Spirit would be working in their lives, and he would bring to their minds the word so that Jesus said to them, to keep them on the path, to keep them faithful, to allow them to be used of God to their full capacity. And this is what the Holy Spirit, this is only a portion of his ministry. We're going to talk about it more in John 16. The work of the Holy Spirit continues. But I want you to understand that peace is found in the person of the Holy Spirit. Have you heard his voice lately? Have you felt his presence lately? Now, it's not all about feelings. It's not all about it. But I wouldn't want to have the type of Christianity where I never feel my God. You know, often I feel him. Often he overwhelms me. Oftentimes he convicts me, the Holy Spirit. You feel that? In a church like this, if you're not feeling it, something's wrong. God, the Spirit, he desires to lead us to have an active role in each one of our lives. And that brings me peace. You know, when the Holy Spirit convicts me, even when the Holy Spirit speaks to me, it assures me that God is still working in me. That he's not done with me. That he hasn't, listen to me, if it gets really, really quiet for a long time, I would worry. I'm not saying that there aren't seasons where I don't sense him as much as in other seasons. There are times like that. Maybe you're in a season like that this morning where you feel like you haven't heard from God. Let me encourage you. Search your heart. Ask him to show you if there's anything that's grieving him. If God is silent this morning, ask him, show me, Lord, reveal to me if there's anything that's grieving you. The promise of peace, the person of peace, but I want to see thirdly this morning, the provision of peace. Listen to this. Listen, look at verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. I read a commentary this week, and it talks about how Jesus specifically said there that he gives his peace, or my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives. That word shalom, you've heard it, right? Some of you have visited Israel or have been around Orthodox Messianic Jews. And oftentimes the greeting is shalom, or when you leave, it's shalom. That word is a precious word to the Jewish people. It means much more than just the absence of war, distress. Right now, let's be in prayer for Israel. Let the peace of God rule and reign in their hearts as they are in war, as they are facing distress. But shalom means wholeness, completeness, health, security, prosperity, in the very best sense. It's a word with a lot of depth to it. When you are enjoying God's peace, there is joy and contentment. There's joy and contentment. How many of you guys know someone who's very wealthy, but they have no peace? The Bible says that they that will to be rich pierce themselves with many sorrows. Those who, they live for money, they live for the accolades and the acknowledgement of men. The Bible says they pierce themselves with many sorrows. Let me tell it to some young person. Don't buy the devil's lie that if you get to this level, if you reach this, if you're a millionaire before you're 25. I know millionaires right now who they have to medicate themselves just to sleep. They don't have the peace. But the righteous, the Bible says, they sleep. They sleep peacefully. The righteous, he gives sleep, the Bible says. And I want you to understand, you guys know we live in a world that offers a false sense of peace, right? Not like Jesus is speaking about here. He says, my peace I leave with you. My peace. You see, the world bases its peace off of resources. But God's peace depends on relationship with him. To be right with God means to enjoy the peace of God. See, the world, they try to find peace in their accomplishments and in their ability. But we as Christians, we depend on the spiritual adequacy of Christ. My peace is found in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is my peace. The reason why I'm at peace with God when I once was an enemy with him, to him, is because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. I have peace with God. And this morning, if you have Jesus' peace in your heart, let me tell you what, you are of most people blessed in the world. You may not have a penny to your name, but if you have the peace of God, it's priceless. There's no price you can put on it. And Jesus said to these men who would face many trials, many testing, he says, my peace I leave with you. And I want you to see Jesus is the ultimate example of this. He is just but hours away from being falsely arrested, tortured, beaten, spit upon, and yet he's able to talk to them. If this were you and I, we wouldn't want to talk to anyone. We wouldn't have time for anybody else. We'd be in our pity party, right? We'd be wanting to be somewhere else. We'd be running for our lives. But here Jesus is facing the most horrible of deaths before him, and he's able to pour into others because of the peace that he possessed. He is the Prince of Peace. And I want us to remember that. See, unsaved people, they enjoy peace when there's an absence of trouble, right? But we as Christians, we enjoy peace in spite of trials. Why? Because of the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. If you're in a trial and you don't have peace as a believer, it's because you're allowing fear to overwhelm your faith. That's it. And I was just reminded of this week. God isn't looking for this great big faith. Listen to me. I get afraid, don't you, sometimes? I remember I was driving in New Mexico where we were driving across country trying to raise money to plant the church in Los Angeles, and a storm, I'm not just a little storm, just came out of nowhere. Let me tell you, we had our little Nissan Altima loaded to the brim. We were living out of a suitcase, and the car would drive like this. You could see it in the back, you know. This storm came out, and it came down hard, and no one else is on the road. It's in the middle of the night, and I'm just going as slow as I can, and I'm like, are we going to make it? I was afraid. And it's like the Holy Spirit said, just pray. Just trust me. I couldn't wake up my wife because I know she'd be freaked out. And it was just me, and the kids were peacefully sleeping in the back. Listen to me. Listen, that's a great analogy. If the Holy Spirit is in control of your life, if you're allowing the Father to lead your life, to direct your life, you can sleep in the storm. You can have peace in the midst of craziness. And so I'm driving and I'm afraid. And I'm praying, God, the next exit is far. God, I want to get off. I can't pull over to the side. I can't see the lines on the freeway. It's so dark and so much snow had fallen in such a short period of time. And I'm praying and it's like right then the Holy 18-wheeler just comes up and he pulls in front of me and he flashes his blinkers. And it's like, follow me. And I'm like, thank you, Lord. And I followed him, and we got off on the next exit, and the truck stopped, and we slept there until we could get through. And I want you to know there's times where we're going to be afraid. But the Bible says, what time I am afraid, I will trust in you, Lord. I will trust in you. He's just looking for a faith that is a mustard seed more than our fear. You know how small a mustard seed is? Some of you say, that's all I got. Well, he can work with it. He doesn't need a mountain of faith. He just needs a mustard seed of faith more than our fear. And he can move a mountain. That's what he has told us in his word. And I want you to see that's what's going to bring us peace. That we have faith in Jesus. My peace I give to you. I leave with you. Not as the world gives. He says, not like the world. Like it's just temporal. It's just conditional. But my peace is unconditional. It's the peace that passeth all understanding. And I want us to just grasp this. Right now, you may not need this sermon, but I'm telling you, one day you will need this sermon. And I will need this sermon. Because there's going to come the test. There's going to come the difficult season. There's going to come the devastating news. And we're going to have his peace. His peace. You see, people in the world, they walk by sight. But we walk by faith. Not by sight. Listen to me. Listen to me this morning, church family. If we walk by sight in our circumstances, this is what we'll be. We'll be like a leaf in the wind. But let me tell you, if you want to be firm on a foundation, on the rock of our salvation, you've got to have faith in him. You've got to believe that he'll bring you through. We heard it last week, that it's all for his glory, right? No matter what we're going through, we may not have chosen this trial, but God has a plan in it. God will work through it. The provision of peace. Jesus said, I will give you my peace. And he says, let not your heart be troubled. This is a choice. We will choose faith or fear. We will choose to allow our hearts to be troubled or to give it to the Lord Jesus Christ. We will choose fear or we'll choose faith. And maybe today God is saying to someone in this room, choose faith. Trust me. Trust me. I've got you. I will bring you through. But I want to see not only does peace provide, is provided by Jesus and it's his peace, but I want you to see it's, there's joy available in the will of God. Look at verse 28. He said, you have heard me say to you, I am going away and coming back to you. And if you love me, you will rejoice because I said to you, I'm going to the Father. And my Father is greater than I. So Jesus is telling these men, you heard me say that I'm going away to my Father. And I'm coming back to you. If you love me, you will rejoice because I am going to my Father. And I want you to get this. Jesus is saying that these men, their hearts were troubled when they should be rejoicing because the will of God was taking place. It was God's plan that Jesus would suffer and die for our sins and then rise from the grave and then ascend to heaven and be reunited with the Father. And they didn't understand all that would come, all that they would benefit from what Jesus is getting ready to endure. You see, his return to the Father made his ministry of intercessory possible. He would be in the throne. You see, he would be there on our behalf, our high priest in heaven, and he would leave the Holy Spirit within us, and we have the Savior above us. And I want you to understand what we have as believers this morning. We have a high priest in heaven who intercedes on our behalf. We have the Holy Spirit of God who lives within us, who keeps us, and who will guide us and teach us all things. We have everything that we need to live godly, to fulfill the will of God in this life. We should rejoice. Like I said, we have it better than many in the Old Testament saints. And he's telling them, you guys should rejoice. If you love me, if you understood me, if you would rejoice that the will of God is being done. But not only, I want you to just get this, and at the end of the verse, I want to just talk about this briefly. I don't want to give too much time to this, but many cults use this verse when Jesus said, I am going to my Father, for my Father is greater than I. And so Jesus is not saying here, he was not denying his equality in his own deity with the Father. What he was saying was, and he wouldn't contradict himself, the Word of God does not contradict itself. What he was saying is, while he was here on earth, he limited his prerogatives of deity as in human form. You guys remember when we talked about when he was transformed, he was his transfiguration on the mount there where Peter, James, and John saw him in his glorified state, right? You see, he veiled his glorified state while on earth. The Bible says that he looked like a normal man. He was nothing to stand out, nothing different about him. He had a comely appearance. And you know that every miracle that Jesus did, he did it by the will of the Father. He never stepped outside of the will of the Father to use his power for his own benefit. And so what he is saying here is not that there's the Father and then Jesus is here. No, what he is saying is, here, I have submitted to the will of the Father. It's just like you in marriage, husband, your wife is not here and you're here. You're equal in Christ. But she, if she's in the will of God, submits to you. She comes under your leadership. And it's a beautiful submission. It's a position of power and authority, because if we're all honest, we know that our wives are our better half. I would forget my head if it wasn't attached to me some days because of my wife and the details that she is privy to, and her intuition and her insight and a lot of things. And so what Jesus is saying here is not that he's less than the Father. What he's saying is that I've submitted to the Father's will and I'm going back to him. We're going to be reunited, and it's going to be a glorious thing, not only for me, but for you, because I'll be there interceding on your behalf, standing as your high priest. Anybody understand that this morning? Say amen. 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 All right. Not only can there be joy found in the will of God, but there's supernatural understanding. Look at verse 29. Jesus says, "And now I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe." These men had insight. They had understanding through Jesus Christ. He gave them the truth. He gave them these promises beforehand. He told them what was going to happen beforehand so that they would have understanding. You understand that the Word of God tells us all that's happening in our world right now. We have, through the Word of God and the Spirit of God, we have supernatural understanding. You understand that? So we aren't rattled when it happens, right? We should not be shaken when the world is doing what the Bible has already said it would do. We should not allow that to rob our peace, because we knew that God said this is what would happen. And you know what it should do? When we see the world going the way that God said it would, it should bolster our faith. It should strengthen our faith. It should cause us to be more bold witnesses to say, look, the Word of God says this would happen, that the end times, that men would become lovers of themselves. Listen to me. We got to wake up, church. We've got to get off of our slumbering stupor and allow God to speak through us and to be witnesses in this time, because we do have supernatural understanding through the Spirit of God and the Word of God. Amen. Somebody needs to hear that. And this is what Jesus is giving to these men, because he knew they would face opposition, persecution, demonic attacks. And he said, I'm telling you now, before it comes to pass, so you can be prepared for the adversity that's ahead. And Jesus was prepared for his time of his passion. He says in verse number 30, I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. As I mentioned before, we do have an adversary who is trying to destroy us, trying to silence us. And you know what he uses a lot to silence Christians? He uses fear. He robs you of your peace so that you aren't bold as a witness. Many of you, we don't share your faith because you're shaking like a leaf right now because things aren't going too well in your perspective, in your earthly, fleshly perspective. And I want to encourage us to understand that, yes, we have a real enemy, but Jesus says about him, he says, and he has nothing in me. So what Jesus was saying there was that he has no power over anything to do with me. He thinks that he's coming to accomplish something, but what he doesn't understand is that he is playing out the role that I have preordained for him to play out. I am in control. And I want to tell somebody that this morning, there may be people in your life who are agents of the enemy, who are causing distress, who are causing hurt, and you may find yourself in the pit like Joseph, but you will be able to say one day that what they meant for evil, God meant for good. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that God will take the ugly in our life, the evil that we've dealt with, the persecution and all of this, that one day he will make, the Bible says, he will make all things beautiful. And I want you to just hold on to that promise and let that be your peace. Let his promises be your peace. His sovereignty, like our pastor says, is our sanity. He is ahead. He said, the ruler of this world, and I want you to get this. We see it being exposed more and more every day that there's a ruler, little case r, of this world. And he's moving in the world, and he's posturing people. He's promoting certain things, but he has no place. He has nothing against our Savior. He has nothing against us. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Remember that, folks. Remember, that's not just a trite saying. That is the word of God. But verse 31, he says, you see, what the provision of peace also is, it helps us to prioritize God's glory. This is what Jesus models here. He says in verse 31, but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, so I do. Arise, let us go from here. You see, Jesus knew that the Father would be glorified through his death and resurrection. And he was able to put that above all things. He was able to make that journey to the cross because he prioritized the Father's glory. Let me ask you this. If the Father's glory in our lives means that we suffer, but we show the peace of God in the midst of that suffering, are you willing? Am I willing to go through that for God's glory? Let me tell you, God gets more glory from the cancer patient going through chemotherapy than we're at Disneyland having a great time and everything's all well. Listen to me, I see it all the time in here. And you guys don't always know it, but I know this person's waiting for that diagnosis from the doctor. This person is going through chemo, and this person is scheduled for this surgery. This person is going through this, and let me tell you, when we walk through those trials and we glorify God, that brings him honor. It's easy when everything is roses and lilies, and it's easy to do to rejoice in God then, but can we rejoice when it's difficult? And I want us to determine, you see, because this is not something that you're going to be able to determine in the moment always. You and I have to be spiritually preparing for this. We have to be walking with God before the news comes. Now, sometimes God allows those things to come in our life and it does draw us to him, but oftentimes if a person is not, if they're playing around with God and something bad comes on, I've seen it so many times, their hearts get hardened towards God. Like, how could you let this happen? But if you're in love with Jesus, You're walking with him, and in his providence, something comes into your life, and it's not what you would have chosen. There's a more likelihood that you will remain faithful. There's a more likelihood that he will fill you with his Spirit and give you the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, and peace in the midst of it. So I want to encourage us this morning. Are you experiencing the gift of peace that Jesus has promised? Are you allowing his Spirit to lead you, to teach you, to guide you, to fill you? Is this your Christian experience? Is this our Christian experience? If it's not, today we've got to ask the Lord to show us what is holding back the fullness of this in our lives. What is hindering God's work in our hearts? Maybe you're here today and you heard me talk about heaven in the beginning, how we can find peace because we know that we're on our way to heaven. You were thinking in your heart, I don't have that assurance. I don't have peace about that. I don't know that when I die, that heaven would be my home. Well, let me tell you, you can know. You can today. All that you have to do is to acknowledge before God that you're a sinner that falls short of his glory, and that you need to be forgiven. You're turning away in repentance to him. You need for him to take that sin. He's already paid for it. You understand? We sung about it this morning when we sang about what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. You see, Jesus shed his blood for the sins of the world. And all that you have to do is ask him to be your Lord, to be your Savior, and he will save you this morning. He will begin construction on your place in heaven today. If you call on his name, the Bible says it's that simple, that if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Saved from what? Saved from an eternity separated from God. You see, the gospel is the good news. And it's only good news because there is bad news, that sin leads to death and separation from God. You see, we all face the first death, separation from this body. But there are some who will face the second death, and that's spiritual separation from God for all of eternity. There is no getting out of that. And that's why the gospel is good news, because we don't have to. I was thinking about it as we sung on Wednesday, that hell lost another one. Every time that someone calls on the name of Jesus, hell loses another one. And I want you to know, God wants to save. He is not willing that any should perish, but that all will come to repentance. And so in this church, we try to keep the main thing the main thing. And the main thing is getting sinners to the Savior, getting people to Christ. So if you're here this morning and you don't have the assurance that heaven will be your home, I want to encourage you to call on his name. In just a few moments, we'll have men and women in the prayer room who are prepared to talk to you if you have questions, and who will love to lead you in receiving the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. But you don't have to talk to anyone. You can just pray in your heart right there in your seat and ask Jesus to save you, and he will do that. He will do that. But maybe you're here this morning and you have not been experiencing the fullness of the Holy Spirit in your life. You have been devoid of peace lately as a believer. The altar will be open. You can come today and ask God to work in your heart to reveal if there's anything that you need to repent of and turn away from, so that you can experience the fullness of his Spirit once again. Anybody been there where you know you've been grieving the Spirit and you haven't been hearing from him? But the moment that we turn to him in repentance, he hears us. And he comes and he fills us once again. I believe that he wants to do that for somebody today. I'm going to ask the worship team to come. In just a moment, we're going to worship. The altar's open. If you need prayer, I'll be over there in the prayer room with the other prayer team members. And I'm going to encourage you to come. If you need Christ especially, come. Don't put it off. If you feel a tugging in your heart this morning, that's the Holy Spirit. He's drawing you. Don't put it off another moment. But I'm going to pray, and we're going to get in worship. Lord, I thank you for your word. Your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And Lord, I pray that we would be the people known for their peace. Your peace would be on full display in us. And God, I know that there are those here in this room who have not been experiencing your peace. And I pray that today would be the day that they seek you and they turn back to you, and that they will be in the center of your will for their lives so that they can experience the fullness of your peace once again. Lord, help us to choose faith over fear every day. And show us how we can grow in that faith, God. Show us, Lord. Stretch us, Lord. Put us in positions where we have nothing but to trust you. And Lord, I know that you're going to be glorified in this church family as we display your peace, Lord. And we thank you for it. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to begin worship. The altar's open. If you need prayer, we'll be over in the prayer room.
Jesus, Jesus, Through it all, it is well.
be calmed and broken from our yeah, God. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well with me. Far be it from me to not believe. Through it all.
well with our soul. God, I pray that you would strengthen your church and that the peace that only you give would be our strength, Lord, that we would be able to have joy in the times of testing and trial and difficulty. And God, I just pray that we would be in your will, that we'd be following your word so that we can experience the fullness of what you have for us. God, I pray you go before us into our homes. Lord, may you be exalted there as well and in our lives. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. You're dismissed.